All right, so thanks everyone for coming to the second lecture on Ricci limit spaces, which is kindly imparted by Dr. Giacchino Antonelli from Scuola Normale Superiore. And so thank you so much, Giacchino, for accepting to teach us this topic. And so please go ahead.
Oh, thank you again for the possibility of putting down all the things that I pretend to know about this topic. Today we will finish the topics of the last lecture, and so we will start with a recap about Gromov-Hausdorff of distance and convergence. It will be a quick recap, and then we will start with the almost splitting theorem. Okay, so let's finish and the topic of last lecture, and let me recall, okay, the basic references for this part are the book by Burago Buragodivanov, Petersen, Villani, and also the paper by Gili, Mondino and Savare. You find this reference at the beginning of the lecture notes, okay? So what is the Gromov-Hausdorff distance? There are several ways of introducing the Gromov-Hausdorff distance. One effective way is just to take the infimum, so given two metric spaces, you want to measure how far they are from being isometric. And so what you do, you take the infimum among all the possible realization, Z, in which you can isometrically embed your metric spaces. And then what do? You take the Hausdorff distance of these two isometric copies inside the realization. And you take the infimum over all the possibilities, okay? So this is the Gromov-Hausdorff distance. And you can also give a pointwise analog by adding a point here, a privileged point, and just putting plus the distance. So you can give a pointed analog that measures also how far the spaces are far from being isometric with an isometry that sends the first point to the second point, okay? This definition works well for compact metric spaces. You can prove that if the distance is zero, if and only if the spaces are isometric. And moreover, if you take the quotient of the compact metric spaces with this relation, it is a complete and separable metric space, okay? Sometimes it's useful to have in mind another approach, the approach with the Gromov-Hausdorff approximation, okay? So we say that a function between two metric spaces, an epsilon Gromov-Hausdorff approximation, if it has distortion bounded above by epsilon, okay? And it's epsilon almost surjective. So it means that when you send two points to other two points, the difference of the distance is bounded above by epsilon. And also for any point in the range y, you can find a point in the domain such that the distance of the image is less than epsilon from y, okay? So this is an almost distance preserving, and this is an almost surjective. So this is an almost isometry, okay? Good. And the basic fact is that the Gromov-Hausdorff distance can be in some sense measured up to constants by the existence of Gromov-Hausdorff approximation. So you should sometimes think that when two spaces are Gromov-Hausdorff close, there exists an almost isometry between them. So you can prove also by yourself, this is in Villani's book, for example, that if you have two metric spaces, the infimum of the epsilon such that there exists an epsilon Gromov-Hausdorff approximation is bounded by above and below by a constant multiple of the Gromov-Hausdorff distance. The Gromov-Hausdorff distance, as I introduced, is okay for compact spaces, but for non-compact spaces, it somehow can have some problem. And you can try to show by exercise that if you take a compact space and a non-compact space, the Gromov-Hausdorff distance between them is infinity, okay? And so maybe you need to adjust the definition to take into account a better way to measure how far two non-compact metric spaces are from being isometric, okay? So that's why now I will introduce to the Gromov-Hausdorff convergence in the non-compact case, but I will not introduce a definition of distance, I will introduce a definition of convergence, okay? So we say that and now when we are dealing with non-compact space, it's essential to fix a point, okay, from which we are looking at the space. So we say that the sequence of metric spaces, pointed metric spaces, pointed Gromov-Hausdorff converge to a pointed metric space is when We have a complete and separable. Okay, from now on, all the spaces will be complete and separable. When we have a complete and separable spaces and isometric immersions of the approximating sequence and of the last and of the limit in Z, such that, roughly speaking, the isometric copies of all the balls Hausdorff converge in the realization to the isometric copy of the ball of the limit. So for any epsilon and any radius, you can find a sufficiently small, sufficiently big index such that the isometric copy of the ith ball of radius r, the closed ball, okay, is contained in the tubular neighborhood of shape epsilon of the isometric copy of BRY. And the same thing with BRY. So this is nothing to say that the copies are at Hausdorff distance less than epsilon. So the epsilon neighborhood of the rightmost contains the leftmost, and the epsilon neighborhood of the leftmost contains the rightmost. Okay, so this is the Hausdorff distance. Okay. Such a convergence is metrizable. And I suggest you to have a look to the paper of Gilli, Mondino, and Savare, in which I think that there is a kind of good presentation of the Gromov-Hausdorff convergence with a distance and the equivalence class of pointed metric spaces and all with this distance is again complete and separable. And also this notion of convergence is equivalent to all the other notion of convergence and distances in the class of locally uniformly doubling pointed metric spaces, which will be the class on which we will be focusing during the lecture. So I think that also sometimes it's better to have in mind these extrinsic definitions so that you can really take a realization, fix a realization, and do all the computation in this realization. Okay.
Sorry, Giacchino. So for the separability in the compact case, I remember the countable density is the set of finite metric spaces, I guess, right? And for the so for the separability of this set of metric spaces.
Yes.
So in the compact case, that's given because the finite metric spaces are dense, no?
Yes, exactly.
And in the non-compact case, how does one?
I think that it's just to you have a countable union of balls, okay?
Right.
You can take finite epsilon nets on these larger balls. So you have a countable sequence of radii going to infinity and a countable nets on each ball.
Yeah,
so
okay.
Countable times countable is countable. So this is the idea, okay?
All right, thanks. Okay.
Okay. So yes, just take, yes, the in some sense you take the exhaustion with balls that
with
are
balls.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Awesome. Thanks.
So, given a realization space Z, one can define a notion of convergence of points. Okay. So when we have a point in the Gromov-Hausdorff convergence, I will always think about let's fix a realization, and then we can speak about the convergence of points in this realization. So we can speak about the convergence of variable points in the approximating sequence to a point in the limit, and also we can speak about convergence of sets, which will be just the Hausdorff convergence in the realization. So fixing a realization, we can speak about convergence of variable points and sets. Okay. Now it's better also to recall you what is the pointwise convergence of functions. So if we have a pointed Gromov-Hausdorff sequence that converges to a limit and we fix a realization, we say that a sequence of function converge pointwise to a limit if you have the sequential convergence in the realization. So anytime you have a variable sequence converging to a limit point, the function on this sequence converge to the limit function at this point. So this is the pointwise convergence. And also you can give a notion of a uniform convergence, just asking, okay, for any epsilon, we have a big N such that from some point on in the convergence, and for every point, variable point, there is a distance bounded above by the inverse of this big number n, then you have the uniform continuity. So it's just the clearest definition of uniform convergence that you can imagine in the realization, okay? And this that will be a crucial tool is the fact that you can prove an Ascoli-Arzelà theorem for realization, for Lipschitz function, for actually equi-uniformly continuous functions that are bounded. I just stated here for Lipschitz because it will be the only case we will be dealing with. So assume that you have a sequence converging to a limit and fix a realization. And also assume that you have a sequence of functions that are L Lipschitz with L is fixed, and assume that they are uniformly bounded on the points xj, okay? Then the classical Ascoli-Arzelà result holds. You have a L Lipschitz function on the limit. Oh, sorry, I don't know why there is x infinity here. There should be y. Okay. Yes, if you see some of these typos, let me know. there is an L Lipschitz function such that up to subsequence, the functions restrict to every ball of radius R converge uniformly. So that up to subsequence, the function uniformly converge on compact cells. Okay? So this is the classical Ascoli-Arzelà theorem, and it holds with approximating sequences, pointed Gromov-Hausdorff converging to a limit. And now I want to recall you the one of the basic results in the theory that motivated the study of the limits of Riemannian manifold to Ricci covariance bounded from below. And I stated you as an abstract theorem, and it's the Gromov compactness theorem in the pointed Gromov-Hausdorff topology, in the Gromov-Hausdorff topology. This theorem tells you that if you have a class of compact metric spaces with uniformly bounded diameter, the following are equivalent. C is pre-compact in the Gromov-Hausdorff topology, or you can bound uniformly in C the epsilon capacity of the metric spaces in C. What does it mean? That there exists a function such that the maximum number of disjointed epsilon half balls in X is bounded above independently on X by this function. Okay, this may change with epsilon, okay? So in some sense, this theorem tells you that the things that you really have to look at is the fact that these spaces in some sense uniformly bounded above nets inside of them, okay? And this is somehow linked to what Jesus told, and you can imagine, you can take then finite metric spaces and use precompactness on that to obtain the limit, okay? Finer and finer, okay. But also, you can also ask that the minimum, that epsilon covering is uniformly bounded above. So the minimum number of epsilon balls needs to cover X. So this is the Gromov the compactness theorem. And okay, localizing the previous criterion and using Bishop-Gromov, okay, so if you fix a ball in a Riemannian manifold with Ricci bounded from below, you can, by means of Bishop-Gromov comparison theorem that I proved last time, you can really bound any of these two numbers with a function that only depends on the radius of the ball that you fixed and also on the bounds on the curvature. Then, localizing this criterion, you can have this proposition, which is the fact which is the fact that the class of pointed, complete, Riemannian manifold with Ricci bounded from below is precompact in the pointed Gromov-Hausdorff topology. So this is the beginning of the theory of Ricci limit spaces. Any limit of complete Riemannian manifolds, the sequence of complete Riemannian manifolds pointed with Ricci bound from below is called a Ricci limit space. And okay, this finishes the last part of the lecture. If you have question, feel free to ask now.
So can I ask?
Yes.
So the limit space up to now of this complete Riemannian manifold with the bound on the Ricci is just for now a metric space. So it doesn't.
The metric space, yes. You can, sorry, finish the question.
So it doesn't up to now preserve any differentiable structure?
No, not at all. Okay. The only thing that you can, at this level of the things that I told you, that you can show as an exercise is the fact that it's preserved, the fact that it is aboundedly compact, it's a length space. Maybe you, so at this level, as an exercise, you can show this. And then, as you can imagine, so this is a brief spin-off, this led to a huge, very rich and flourishing literature about the study of structure results, and that was mainly started by Chigger and Kolding in two fundamental papers in 96 and 97, basing on a previous result by Kolding. And then there are some striking contributions by Kolding and neighbor, by Chigger and neighbor, and Chigger, Jiang and neighbor, just to list some of them, okay? So now, what? In the remaining part of this mini course, I will try to give you the proof, the full proof of two structure results. And I will try to explain you how they are useful to prove structure results for Ricci limit spaces. So,
can you have a question before?
Yeah.
Ask a question. So, this result where you say that I bound Ricci from below is some sort of convexity. No, is there some type of Alexandrov theorem here that you can use in the previous part? Something like, is it true that Ricci bounded from below implies this Lipschitz condition or this Arcelas-Cauchy to get the compactness?
I don't get the question.
So in the previous slide, no? So you say that to have compactness, it suffices to bound Ricci from below.
Yeah.
So this remind me kind of convex functions are Lipschitz, no? So you have automatically kind of the Arcelas-Cauchy. Is there something like that playing a role here, or even more general, like if I have something like a Ricci bounded from below, do I have an Alexandrov theorem in the sense that the function, the manifold is going to be C11 almost everywhere?
No, those are smooth manifold. Those are really C infinity manifold. Okay. So maybe the there is a connection in some sense. The fact that the Ricci curvature bound from below is in some sense directly implies this by means of Bishop Gromov. Okay, so this encodes in some sense the Ascoli-Arzelà property to go to the pre-compact case, to show the pre-compactness. So in some sense, yes, but I don't know a better answer to this question. But this is, I think that, yes, this implies kind of equi-boundedness, equi-epsilon boundedness of closed ball in the Riemannian manifolds. So yes, it's something similar to Ascoli-Arzelà.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, and so let's start with the almost splitting theorem. In the first part of the second lecture, I will give you the statement of the splitting and the almost splitting theorem, and then there will be an informative part in which I will list you some of the results that you can prove with the splitting theorem. And so it will be like a collection of useful facts. And then in the second part, I will give you the full proof of the first part of the almost splitting theorem that then we will conclude later on. Again, here in the first two pages, you will find all the references that I will cite during the lectures. The most important one are, okay, obviously the paper by Ciger and Gromol on about the splitting theorem and the Aschenburg-Hanse that gave an elementary proof of the Ciger-Gromol splitting theorem. And also the fundamental reference is the first of the paper by Ciger and Colding, the one on annals in 96, on which they prove the one in 96 and the one in 97, which they prove the almost splitting theorem. All the other references are here because I will cite them in this informative part of the lectures. And I will mention sometimes the contribution in the non-smooth theory, okay? So the CD, RCD setting, but it's not the main topic of this course, otherwise there will be no time of doing anything with full details. And so I just tell you here that the fundamental references that made the theory start are the papers by Lotte, Milani, and Sturm. And if you want to read how the theory started and evolved, you can read the survey of Ambrosio at the International Congress of Mathematics. Okay. So let's start with the splitting theorem. So the classical splitting theorem, the result by Ciger and Gromol in 71. And it says something very simple to state. If you have a complete Riemannian manifold with non-negative Ricci, and you have a line which is an isometric embedding of R into M, so that means the distance between gamma of S and gamma of T is the modulus of T minus S, then you split the line. M is isometric to R times M. And the proof that I will show you, I think, is very elegant. And it can really be concentrated here in these four steps. And the fact is that if you have a line, you can separate it in two rays, gamma plus and gamma minus, and associate to each of these rays the Busemann function, okay, which is the limit of, you take a point here, you take t, so the bt function is the distance between this and this minus t, and you take it to infinity, t, you can prove that b plus, so related to this gamma plus, is a Lipschitz function, and also if you do it with b minus. But why this is tricky? Because the non-negative Ricci condition and the Laplacian comparison that I showed you, you can also, by exercise, try to fill in the details of this proof. I wrote all the details, basically. You can prove that the sum of the two Busemann function is superharmonic, but by the very definition, it's equal to zero on gamma, and they are positive, and it's positive by the triangular inequality. So what you obtain that this is, that the sum is identically equal to zero, and then B plus and B minus are harmonic, and then are smooth, okay? But now take the square of the gradient of one of them, and by Buchner and step two, you can find that this is subharmonic. But since it is the limit of Lipschitz function with Lipschitz constant less or equal than one, the gradient is less than one and it's equal to one on the geodesic. Then again, now the maximum minimum principle tells you that the square gradient of B plus is one. Now put together the two steps and you obtain that the Hessian is zero, okay? So you have a function that is harmonic as constant gradient and action zero. So it's something like a distance. What you do, you take the zero level set of B plus and you flow it by the gradient of B plus. And you show that the flow is by isometry and you are splitting the manifold along the zero level set of the Boosman function. This is the idea of the splitting theorem. And now that we have the idea of the splitting theorem, I want to show you what is the statement of the almost splitting theorem, okay? So this is a theorem due to Chigger and Colding, and you can see the picture. I will discuss it. You have 3 points. So this is the almost situation of the splitting theorem. So you have a big geodesic, okay, tending to infinity, q plus and q minus are really distant one from the other. And you have a third point, which is roughly on a geodesic between them. So this is the almost version. And what you want to say is that a smaller ball in the eye of this point is close to split. So this is the almost version, and I will tell it to you. So if we have a manifold that satisfies Ricci, so I will use properly the quantifier. For every epsilon, there exists delta such that if the manifold satisfied Ricci is almost non-negative, okay? And P, Q plus, Q minus are 3 points such that what? P is far apart from Q plus and Q minus. And the excess, I will tell you what is the excess, it's just the error in the triangle inequality. And this is less than delta, then you are close in the point of the Gromov-Hausdorff sense to split a factor R. Well, X zero is in XR and X is a boundedly compact metric space, boundedly compact length metric space. So this is exactly the almost version of the theorem that I told you. You are allowing the manifold to have some little non-negative, some little negative Ricci curvature. You allow the points to be slightly next to a geodesic connecting Q plus and Q minus, but it's still very far from it. So we are giving an almost version of the previous theorem. And what I'm telling to you, what Chigger and Colding proved, is that this is true, okay? So the ball there is close to split ball. Okay, so, and if you give me a threshold, I can find you a very, 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 very small delta such that this holds, okay? So some questions so far?
So why this theorem? So why the necessity of proving this?
Okay, and this is written here.
Ah, okay.
Wait to slides.
Yes,
you,
yes.
Okay. You will find the answer to this question. Okay.
So Giacchino, so this is at scale one, right? So the balls are of radius one. If is this somehow kind of continuous if I modify the radius, or can one always obtain an almost splitting theorem if I want to see it at some fixed scale? Or
yes, you can put whatever number you want. Obviously, right. Delta will depend on R here.
Right. Okay.
So you can say, okay, R is 1 million, and then delta will depend on epsilon, the dimension, and on one R. So it will be probably slightly smaller. So you should be very, very far, but at the end, so if you fix a scale then you go with delta to zero, you always find that the ball of 1 million is close
right.
to
50. Okay.
Before explaining why this is true, I will state a consequence of this theorem, and I will explain why this consequence is useful. So this is a theorem by Chigar and Kolding in 97, so in the JDG paper. Assume that you have a rich limit space, which is the limit of more and more non-negative rich. So you allow some negative rich curvature, but this bound is going to zero, okay? So you take a rich limit space in this way, and assume that you have a line in this rich limit space. Hence, there exists a complete boundedly compact length space such that X is isometric to R times Y, okay? So this is a generalization in this non-smooth case of the splitting theorem by Chigar and Gromov. And this is a direct consequence of the almost splitting theorem. Why? Because, okay, without loss of generality, you can assume that the point is on the line, because if you fix a realization and you take a line, you take a point on the line and you can find an approximating sequence such that, okay, if you change the X tilde, you can put X tilde Y. So if, and you have the point at the Gromov-Hausdorff convergence. So let us assume that the point is on the line. And what? Okay, let's use the observation that Jesus asked me for. We can take a sequence of increasingly big radii, and then what? We take, okay, so with that big Ri, there is probably a very small delta I. And what I do? I choose two points on the geodesics that are more than delta I to the minus one, and I approximate this with the approximating sequence. At some point, since the distance are continuous with respect to pointed Gromov-Hausdorff convergence, we are exactly in the situation of the figure before, because the delta I, you should think another sequence, okay? At some point, we will, with the delta I there, we will be less than the delta I that we fixed, okay? The point will be far apart, and then what? The ball of radius Ri up to subsequence will be next to the ball of radius Ri in some splitted metric spaces with R, okay? So there is a diagonal process. You should think about the diagonal process. There is not a problem. But now what? You use the fact that Ri is going to infinity, and you use that up to subsequence, since Zi are subsets in spaces that have the capacity bounded, then also on the subsets, you can use the Gromov precompactness, no? Okay? And you have up to subsequence that Zi are converging to some Z. And then from the fact that the manifolds are converging to X, and also the fact that this convergence factorized through R, so if you take R times, this goes in the pointed Gromov-Hausdorff sense to R times Z, and you obtain that for any radius that you give me, the ball of radius R, the closed ball, is as a distance zero from the ball of radius zero Z in R times Z of radius R. So what? You can compose the isometry for a bigger and bigger R, and you obtain that X is isometric to R times Z. This is the idea. So from the almost splitting version of the splitting theorem, okay, you obtain the splitting for rich limit space. So we upgraded the splitting theorem from smooth manifold to limits of smooth manifold that are in some sense still with non-negative Ricci curvature, okay? In the sense that are limits of manifolds that tends to have non-negative Ricci curvature. And what this is used for, and this is the answer to the question of Francesco, This was proved by Chigurh and Colding mainly to prove structure results for the Ricci limit spaces. So they wanted to understand to what extent, I think you can speak about geometry on these Ricci limit spaces. And one consequence of the splitting theorem for Ricci limit spaces is that if you couple it with the reduction of the dimension argument, that is due to a Federer, I think, one can prove by iteration this theorem. It is a theorem in the JDG paper. If you have a non-collapsed, what does it mean, a non-collapsed Ricci limit space? So I think that I forget to tell this. In the approximating sequence, if you require that the inf of the volume of the ball of radius one is strictly positive, so if you require non-collapseness, this is called a non-collapsed Ricci limit space. Okay. So if you have a I wrote it here. I didn't remember. So you have a limit with the Ricci bounding from below by minus one and volume of the ball of radius one strictly detached by zero, you can define what, and I will give you the precise definition of regular point in the next slide, the k singular strata. So the points here that are not regular, and I will explain later, but every tangent cone, and I will also explain what is a tangent cone, doesn't split a factor rk plus one. So what you should have in mind is that, okay, let's try to understand the geometry of these Ricci limit spaces. So let's go and let's study the blow-ups. If at some point all the blow-ups are rk, then we say that that is a k regular points. But then, okay, you exhaust all the k regular points, but then you have singular points and you can stratify the set of singular points, i.e. the points for which there exists at least one tangent that is not isometric to a Euclidean space, you can stratify by asking more and more splitting on the tangent cone. So what you can prove directly with the splitting of Ricci limit space and the reduction of the dimension is that the Hausdorff dimension of the k singular strata is less or equal than k. And for the RCD version, this has been proved by Gigli and De Filippis for non-collapsed RCD spaces. What is a tangent cone? A tangent cone is a notion that you can really give at the level of the metric. So if you have a metric space and a point on it, we say that Y is a tangent space at X if you have an infinitesimal sequence such that if you rescale the metric with Ri to minus one, so you're blowing up, this converges to Y in the point of the Gromov-Hausdorff topology. It can be the case that you never have the existence of these limits, okay? But if they exist, they are called tangent. For example, for a Ricci limit space, you can always show that at any point you have at least one tangent cone. And this is a consequence again of Gromov precompactness theorem. So the regular points that I mentioned before are just the point of the Ricci limit space at which every tangent cone is isometric to RK. Okay. So what? Now I will start an informative part of the lecture, and I want to give you some hints about the development of this theory. One of the questions was, is there a notion of geometric dimension of this Ricci limit space? And there took quite 20 years to answer this question. And the fact is that, and the answer is yes, by calling a neighbor in 2013, if you have a Ricci limit space, so first by the work of Chigurh and Colding that based on Fukaya's ideas you can show that there is a Radon measure on the limit such that this measure happens in the pointed measure Gromov-Hausdorff topology. Sorry, probably I didn't tell you what does it mean having the measure, but think in a realization, I think that here you have a measure mu I. You take the isometric embeddings and you ask just that the push forward of the measure in the realization converge in the usual weak topology to the push forward of the isometric embedding in mu, okay? So dissolving the pointed measure Gromov-Hausdorff topology, so up to here, this is the contribution of Chigger and Kolding. And here is a fundamental contribution of Kolding and Naber. There exists a unique K such that new almost all the points of X are in RK. So you have a well-defined notion of dimension. So it's this K, this geometric dimension, okay? This was then generalized in the RCD setting. So when I say RCD, you should think that it's a synthetic way to encode Ricci bound from below and dimension bounded from above by Brue and Semola. And the older continuity property that is at the core of the proof of this result by Kolding and Naber was generalized in a recent paper by Qin Deng in 2021, okay? You should pay attention because in the collapsed case, so when you have no bound from below on the volume of unit balls, the Hausdorff dimension of the Ricci limit space, sometimes I call X, sometimes I call Y, might be greater than the rectifiability dimension. So this is the rectifiability dimension. It was a long-standing open question, and an example was given some months ago by Xinpeng and Guofang Wei in this 2021 paper. In the collapsed case, you can show that the Hausdorff dimension is n, and actually the Radon measure is up to constant, the Hausdorff n-dimensional measure, okay? And for the structure of the measure in the RCD setting, essentially the fact that if you restrict nu to the RK, you obtain something that is absolutely continuous with respect to the K dimensional Hausdorff measure. This is known since the contribution of Gili Pasqualetto, Kel Mondino, De Filippis Marchese Rindler, and Mondino and Naber. Okay. Good. But what next? What next? Chigger Naber, Chigger Jiang Naber pushed away the theory, pushed forward the theory, and they wanted to understand if these K singular strata are rectifiable. And in this Invenciones paper of Chigger Naber in 2013, they show quantitative estimates on some effective version of the singular strata. So as K are all the points at which no tangent cone splits off an RK plus one. So you can define a quantitative version just asking that you have a quantified distance at all scale greater than R from every tangent cone that splits RK plus one. And what you can prove is that you have a kind of tubular neighborhood estimate, but this was what was proved by Chigger and Naber in 2013, but with an error of eta here that they at the beginning were not able to remove. You can show by exercise, it's written in Lemma 2.5 of paper of myself with Eli and Daniela, that this is stronger than the fact that the Hausdorff dimension is less or equal than K, as was already noticed by Chigger and Naber. But the main point was to improve and cut away this minus eta. And this was done in this Annals paper by Chigger and Chiang and Naber. And this, since the singular set is the union over eta of the intersection over R of the quantitative singular strata, this implies, with the argument in the paper by Chigger and Chiang and Naber, that SK is K rectifiable, actually. So the singular strata are K rectifiable at HK almost every point, every tangent cone splits isometrically RK. So you have really a stratification, okay? And moreover, the Ricci limit space is by order homeomorphic to a smooth manifold outside, okay, the fact that it's by order homeomorphic to a smooth manifold outside the set of codimension 2 was already known by the paper of Chigger and Colding's theorem 8.1.8, okay? And the fact that it's outside the rectifiable set of codimension 2, you can add the word rectifiable because of the result by Chigger, Zhang, and number. So your Ricci limit space is actually outside a rectifiable set of codimension 2, really a holder manifold. And also, okay, for the version of Chigger and Neighbor, the paper about the estimate in singular strata, you can see that in the RCD spaces with the measure HN, you can see the work of myself with Elia and Daniela. And also, there are some beautiful works that based on the idea of Chigger and Neighbor, that are the works by Kapovic and Mondino and by Bruen, Neighbor and Semola, that deals with some related questions to the work of Chigger and Neighbor and Chigger, Zhang and Neighbor, but in the RCD space with a reference measure HN. And you can find some generalization of the rectifiability results for k equal to n minus 2 on RCD spaces in the paper by Bruen, Neighbor and Semola. What is, I just want to tell you, and they also deal with the boundary, I just want to tell you what is a good notion of boundary in the Ricci limit space, in the RCD space. You just take the closure of all the points that split, sorry, this should be n minus 1, n minus 2. That to take the points at which all the blowups are half spaces, take the closure of this. This is a notion of boundary, okay? And if you want, if you are interested to read some conjectures on these topics, you can read the paper on sigma by Neighbor and Honda in 2020. Okay. I just want to finish this first part with the statement of the splitting theorem for RCD spaces that is due to Gigli, it's a fundamental contribution by Gigli. Just to give you what is the non-smooth realm on which you can, you have the same result. So if you have a metric measure space that is an RCD space, so sorry if I didn't introduce, but it would take so long. CD means just something like a synthetic version of this, and R just think Riemannian. So the fact that you are cutting away the Finsler structures from the theory. Okay. So if an RCD zero n space is with if X contains a line, okay, and you should also ask that. Gamma is in the support of the measure, okay? Hence, the metric measure space is isomorphic as a metric measure space to a splitted space. So an information that you don't have at level of Chigger and Colding paper is the fact that also the measure splits, okay? And also another information is that the theory is sufficiently good to tell you that the factor that split it is an RCD 0 n minus 1 metric measure space. So the bound of the dimension is less than 1. And this is an information that it could have been really difficult to obtain in the Ricci limit spaces because you should have proved that it's the limit of Riemannian manifolds of one dimension less. And as far as I know, there is nothing like this in the literature in the classical case. So you obtain new information about the splitted factor. Okay, so this is what I wanted to tell you for this first part of the lecture. And so let's have a 5 minutes break. And if you want to ask me questions, then we will start with the definition of delta splitting maps. And I will show the first part of the almost splitting theorem. So from now on, the main aim will be to prove your non-splitting theorem.
Right, sounds great. If there's any question, please feel free to.
I have a question. So you were saying that, hi, Joaquin.
Hi, Joaquin.
So you were trying to explain like why it's nice to have this almost splitting theorem, or and you mentioned at the end that there is refined results about the singular the strata, and now we know that it's rectifiable, which I guess mathematically is very nice. But I mean, do people expect to use these results to do what?
Okay. This is a different type of questions.
Yeah.
I admit that I don't have a precise answer, but I think that yes. Yes, I just focused on the fact that okay, there are those rich limit spaces. I want to tell you at the best what is the structure of these rich limit spaces, of these RCD spaces. So it's just for the sake of understanding
how the space looks like,
the level, the geometry of the spaces in a very good way.
Mm-hmm.
Applications. I don't know.
Okay.
But I will check.
Yes, thank you.
So I have a question.
Yeah.
So you always say when the RCD spaces come in, you say the non-smooth case.
Mm-hmm.
You seem to imply that the theory of The other theory you're dealing with is the smooth theory. So why is that?
No, it's smooth in some sense. Okay, it's not the good term probably. The fact is that when you are dealing with rich limit space, and when you are proving things with rich limit space, you can really take an advantage from the fact that you have an approximating sequence. So what you are doing at the last level, so in the non-smooth last space, you are just proving it for the approximating sequence, and then you go to the limit. So this is smooth in this sense. So in the arguments, all the arguments in the paper by Chigan and Colding were in some sense smooth. In fact, that they held at the level of the Riemannian manifolds and they went to the limit. When I say non-smooth, I say that when you're dealing with the theory of RCD spaces, you work at the level of RCD spaces. You don't need an approximating sequence. I think it's the same difference between dealing with Riemannian integrable functions and Lebesgue integrable functions. So when you prove things, when you study the theory of Riemannian integration, you say that you have an approximating functions that goes and the area goes from above and from below. So you do things by approximation. But then in the theory of Lebesgue integrable function, you you build the theory in such a way that you don't need every time to approximate with the smooth function. Not so smooth in the case of Riemannian, but okay. This is the idea. So in all the proofs in RCD spaces, you can argue at level of metric measure structure. And in all the proofs that I'm aware of in Ricci limit spaces, you prove statements on Riemannian manifolds and you go to the limit. So it's a smooth argument pushed to the limit.
Okay, I see, thanks.
I guess I have a follow-up question to that. So is it still not known whether all RCD spaces could be seen as Ricci limit spaces? I guess no. Yeah, probably.
So there is an example. There is the cone over the two projective real plane is an RCD 03 space, but it's not possible to obtain it as a limit of three-dimensional manifolds with non-collapsed condition on the volume of unit poles. That's why there are some structural results in the three-dimensional case that tell you that the non-collapsed Ricci limit space is as essentially homeomorphic to a smooth manifold, and the cone over the projective plane is not homeomorphic to a smooth manifold.
Okay, thanks.
The results about the manifold structure of Ricci limit space in dimension 3 are due to Topping, to Simon and other authors, and are based, I think, on the technique coming from the study of the Ricci flow.
So that's only for non-collapse, right?
That's only for non-collapse. Actually, if you have a bound from below the volume of unit poles, I don't know if there is I think that this is open, if there is an RCD space that it's not possible to obtain as a collapsed or non-collapsed limit of Riemannian manifolds. I think that this is open.
Right. I guess I'm a bit confused because three-dimensional Alexandrov spaces, those would be RCDK three spaces, right?
Yeah.
Then, so what does the structural result say again about them being smooth manifolds or?
What, sorry?
So what was the structure result again for non-collapsed three-dimensional Ricci limit spaces? Because Alexandrov spaces, I guess those would be non-collapsed RCD K3 spaces, right? But those have singularity. So
okay, you should check the I don't remember the correct statement, but you will easily find it on archive, but I think that they are homeomorphic to a smooth manifold, not diffeomorphic. It's just at level of C0.
Okay.
The result, but you should check it, is that non-collapsed Ricci limit space in three dimension is homeomorphic to a smooth manifold. But I will check it. I don't want to say something wrong. And maybe I don't know it very well.
I'll check also, thanks.
it's in a paper by Topping and Simon, I think.
Okay. Thanks.
Other questions?
Well, I think everything is very clear.
Let's go. I think I will not be able to finish the second lecture also today, but it's okay. So at least I don't have to prepare the fourth lecture.
All right.
Let's go. Let's define the delta splitting maps. And so what is a delta splitting map? It's something, it's an harmonic map with a special structure. Okay, so if you give me a natural number and two number epsilon and r and a point p, I now want to tell you what is a k epsilon splitting map on the ball BRP. Is a smooth function with k component such that all the components are harmonic . You have an L infinity bound on the gradient which is less than y plus epsilon. Then you have the fact that the function are almost orthogonal in the integral sense, okay? And they have almost vanishing L2 norm of the Hessian in L2 sense. So you remember in the case k equal to one, if epsilon is zero, we obtain an harmonic function, one Lipschitz, with constant gradient equal to one, and with Hessian equal to zero. So it's exactly the function that gave the splitting in the classical splitting theorem. So a delta splitting map is a function that is close in an integral sense to be a function that gives you a splitting, okay? Now an observation that I will crucially use to simplify the proof. If you have a function that satisfies 1, 3, and 4 at the scale R, and Ricci is greater or equal than minus epsilon, then you can prove just the fact that you have an L infinity bound of gradient or U to prove that this improves on a slightly smaller ball to the condition two. Psi epsilon is something to tell you a quantity depending on epsilon that goes to zero as epsilon goes to zero. So if you are on an almost non-negative Ricci manifold, you can just check 1, 3, and 4 to obtain up to something going to zero, the third, giving for granted that you know that you have an L infinity bound on the gradient, okay? And you have this just on a slightly smaller ball. And this is an observation contained in the Annals paper by Chigger and Neighbor in 2015. You have the precise reference, and you can also see the argument in Bruenhaber and Semola paper at page 17. And I just sketched it here, but it's not important. So when I want you to show the existence of a delta splitting map on an almost non-negative Ricci curvature, I will just prove 1, 3, and 4. Okay. And now what? So the existence of a splitting map is something at the level of analysis. So you have a function. So it's something concerning the analysis, okay? And you can prove a theorem that tells you that this analytic information gives rise to a geometric information. So in some sense, you can pass from analysis to geometry. And the theorem is the following one. For every epsilon, you have a delta such that the following holds. If mg satisfies Ricci almost non-negative quantified by delta, and you have a K delta splitting map on a ball of radius 16 around the point P in M, so this is in M, okay, hence you have the existence of a complete length metric space such that the point at the Gromov-Hausdorff distance between the ball of radius 1 centered at P and the ball of radius one centered at some point in a splitted space is less than epsilon, where zero ZK is in Z times RK. So again, if you give me a little threshold, I can find you as very, very, very little delta, such that on a almost non-negative Ricci manifold, if you give me a K delta splitting map on a ball of radius 16, then at the ball of radius one, you have that the pointed ball is close to split RK factor. So, okay, this is the quantitative version of the argument that I showed you before in Chigger and Gromov splitting theorem. The modern version for RCD spaces is contained in the paper by Bruin, Pasqualetto, and Semula in 2019, proposition 3.7. I will not give you the details, but if you want, it's there. And the amazing fact is that this holds also in the other way. So you can pass from analysis to geometry, but you can also pass from geometry to analysis. And for any, you can prove the analogous version, I just state you for completeness, if you have, for every epsilon, you have a delta, such that if M is almost non-negative Ricci curved, and the balls are in the pointed Gromov-Hausdorff sense, close to be isometric, okay, at a scale delta to the minus one, so on a big scale, then you get the existence of a K epsilon splitting map. And the idea is that you take the harmonic replacement of the distances along orthonormal vectors. So you use the Gromov-Hausdorff approximation to build some fake distances on your ball, and then you harmonic replace them, and you obtain a K epsilon splitting map. You can also try to prove this by exercise, so I think it's okay. But the modern version is in proposition 3.9, okay. And I just want to quickly tell you some other results. So what happens when you are not Gromov-Hausdorff close to split, but you are Gromov-Hausdorff close to Rn. So you are Gromov-Hausdorff close to split everything. And the fact is that the existence of the splitting maps give you information on the volumes, and you have this celebrated result by Colding, the volume convergence theorem, that tells you that if you give me a threshold epsilon and fix a dimension, you find the number, okay, you can take the same number here, up to take the minimum of the two, such that on an almost non-negative Ricci curvature, if the Gromov-Hausdorff distance between a ball of radius one around the point is almost zero with the ball in Euclidean space, then the volume on a slightly smaller ball is close to Euclidean one. So on an almost non-negative Ricci curvature, you have that the Gromov-Hausdorff closeness implies volume closeness. And you have the vice versa. Okay, and from this you have non-trivial consequences. You have a version of Reifenberg theorem for almost non-negative Ricci curvature. So you can prove that if you give me an epsilon, I can give you a delta such that on an almost non-negative Ricci curvature, if the balls are almost close, then this closeness improves at all the scales below one. This is not trivial because of the R here. Okay, so if you have the Gromov-Hausdorff closeness to the ball of Rn at one scale, this propagates at all scales below, okay? And why this? Because if you have a Gromov-Hausdorff close to the ball of Rn, then you have volume closeness. But the fundamental fact is that the Bishop-Gromov theory, or the Bishop-Gromov theorem holds. So the volume closeness by monotonicity goes to all the scales below. And when you go to all scale below, you can pass the Gromov-Hausdorff closeness by using the second part of this theorem. And this gives you this absolutely non-trivial result. There is a kind of Reifenberg theorem. If you at one scale close to Rn, at all scale below, if you have a control on Ricci, you are, okay. close to Rn. And this implies that if at a point of a Ricci limit space, one tangent cone is Rn, then all the tangent cones are Rn. Because that means that at some scale, you are close to Brn and almost non-negative, because when you blow up the Ricci limit space, you have a bound from below the Ricci curvature that is somehow close to B0. And then at all scale below, you are close to Brn, and then all the tangent that you can have are Rn. And also another consequence is that if you have the point at Gromov-Hausdorff convergence, so if you have a Ricci limit space and non-collapsed one, something that I told you before, then this improves to a pointed measure Gromov-Hausdorff convergence with the Hausdorff measure. And if you are collapsing, you lose at least one dimension. Okay, so you have the dimension gap. So this is in the JDG paper by Chigare and Colling. And the analogous versions in the RCDKN space with the reference measure HN are in Gili de Filippis. Okay. So before passing to the proof of the almost splitting theorem. So the first part will be the proof of the fact that from splitting maps, you go to splitting spaces. Just a notation alert, okay? I will, from now on, use this notation without paying attention. That is what also it's done in the paper by Chigare and Colling. It doesn't mean that it's wrong, the proof. It means that this psi will change from line to line. And I can also write sometimes psi less than one half psi, because I'm thinking that I can change psi in such a way that it still goes to zero as these quantities goes to zero, okay? And in such a way that this holds. So for example, here, I should think that I can change psi to 10 psi, and I can do that, okay? So just think about this. Psi of delta one, delta k, bar eta one, eta l, stands for a quantity depending on the positive numbers, delta one, delta k, eta one, eta l, and such that this goes to zero as all the variables delta one, delta k goes to zero uniformly on compact sets on which eta one, eta n can vary. Okay. And from now on, this quantity will change from line to line. And the only thing that I want to preserve is that it goes to zero as the quantity on the left part of the bar goes to zero, go to zero. Any questions so far? So if not, let's start the proof of the first part of the almost splitting theorem, okay, that I will conclude next time, I think. So this is, yes, almost splitting theorem, lecture 2.2. Okay, again, the statement. For any epsilon, we have a delta such that if mg is almost non-negative, in a quantified way by delta, and we have a K-delta splitting map, we have a complete length metric space such that the point at Gromov-Hausdorff distance between the ball of radius one centered at P, the ball of radius one in a splitted space is less than epsilon. Okay, so you should think that delta is going to zero. So if epsilon is very small, delta is going to zero. Think like this, okay? And the strategy that I will tell you is mainly elaborated from different parts, from an earlier version of Bamler's notes that I read when I was writing my master thesis, by Chigare's book that I already mentioned to you, The Generation of Riemannian Metrics under Ricci Curvature Bounds, my master thesis, and some notes online that you can find from UCSD, the seminar on Chigare Colding Theory, Ricci Flow, Instant Metrics, and Related Topics. You can find, okay, I just put everything together, I elaborated the details, okay? Okay, so let's start. And I will prove all this theorem with all the details. The first lemma is a kind of an, okay, so what is the idea? The idea is that we want to prove that a zero level set of U is the zeta, okay? So we want to prove in some sense, so the idea is first to prove an approximate Pythagorean theorem on level set of U. And with this approximate Pythagorean theorem, together with an almost surjective property that I will explain later on, we can build a map. So if by contradiction the theorem is not true, we can build a map on a limit space taken by contradiction. We can build a map there such that the approximate Pythagorean theorem becomes a property that tells you this map is distance preserving, and the almost surjective property becomes something that tells you the map is surjective. Then you will have an isometry with the splitted space along the zero level set of the limit of the splitting maps, and you will get the contradiction. This is the idea. And the way it is proved is really geometric. We prove an approximate Pythagorean theorem for zero level set of U. And why this is an approximate? So assuming U is delta splitting, okay, I will give the proof only in the case K equal to one, just to simplify a little bit. And also because this is the only case we will need to give the proof of the almost splitting theorem. Let's assume K equal to one, okay, from now on. So we have this lemma, assume that U is delta splitting on a big ball centered P, and we have a Ricci bound from below. For this lemma, we don't need delta here, but delta is important because it's important to upgrade the L-infinity bound on the gradient of U later on to the delta splitting property. But for this proof, we don't need. Okay. So what? We have condition A that just tells us U, the point X and Z are almost on the same level set of U. Okay, so you should think about this. This is an almost Pythagorean theorem. And the condition B is telling you that if you take the level on which U is, the difference of these two is exactly the distance, is almost the distance. So in some sense, this is a right angle, okay? So A and B tells us, okay, X and Z are on almost on the same level set, and ZW is almost perpendicular to this level set, okay? So what we want to prove is that Pythagoras holds here. There is exactly this statement. And now let's use the analysis to give this geometric condition. And wait a minute. Okay, so what? Let me make a claim and I will explain it. Take this function, which is the gradient square plus the difference of the gradient square, the Hessian square by this difference between one. Okay, and now I claim this. By the segment inequality that I showed you last time, the following goals. So we have W, we have Z, we have X. And I want to tell you, and I want to convince you that I can slightly change these three points in such a way there exists a unique geodesic between these and a unique geodesic for almost all the points here, okay? And such that we have a bound on the integral of H along this geodesic, okay? So the following goals, there exist X tilde, Z tilde, and W tilde in B4P such that first, the sum of the three distances, Y is not here, it's W, is less than psi. All the psi here will be psi of delta n, and I will not. So those are closed. So as delta goes to zero, I want to find a replacement of closed points, and then such that from W bar to Z bar, there exists a unique minimal geodesic sigma. Then sigma will be this. Okay. Such that the integral of H of sigma S, the S is less than psi. So I can control the integral of my function H on the geodesic, and there is a full measure set in this interval such that for any S in U, there exists a unique minimal geodesic from X tilde to sigma S. So you can see this here. This is this is sigma S, and this is tau sigma. Okay. And the integral along the geodesic sigma of the integral along the geodesic tau S. So this is the integral between zero and the distance of X tilde between sigma S, I guess. It's of H tau S T dt ds is less than psi. So what we want to do is to slightly change the points in a controlled way so that they are close, such that we have a unique geodesic here on which the energy of H is bound, is small on sigma. And moreover, for almost every point here, we want that the average of all the energies of the H along the geodesics is bounded. And what will give us the possibility to do this is the segment inequality. If you remember, segment inequality is something that, because we have, look, U is a delta splitting map, so the integral of a big ball of this quantity is less than delta. Then we want to choose points such that this integral bounds passes through to the geodesics, okay? And to convince you of this, there are three slides next, but I will be quick on this. You will find the details in the slides. And if you want to see a written argument, you can see the argument at page 36 and 37 of my master thesis. So recall, what is the statement of the segment inequality? We have two sets, A and B, in the Riemannian manifolds. All, we have a selection of geodesics from almost all the points in A to almost all the points in B. We know that all these geodesics stays in a big W that is a bound on the diameter. And the segment inequality tells us that the average on the energy of F along all these geodesics is bounded above by the energy of F on the big W times a constant that really depends on the bounds on the curvature, case bound on the curvature. So it's better if I put delta here, but I can neglect this because I can fix delta less than one. And the diameter, okay? And the fact, okay, that we also have the sum of the volume, this is okay, obvious. And so what? This is an integral estimate, and here we have something that is bounded above, then we can make a selection, okay? And what was the statement of the iterated one is that, okay, now you have a Z here, and you make the average of this energy, taking the average on all possible geodesics. And you have that this is up to the same constant bounded above by the what? The integral on W of the energy of all the geodesics on W. So this is the iterated splitting rotated segment inequality. We will use this integral estimate and Markov's inequality to select points in a good way. Okay. What do we want to do? We have 3 points, x, z, and w. And we have that on a big ball, the average of the integral of f is bounded by psi, something that goes to zero with delta. And now we want to find the substitutes such that the integral of f along this is less than psi, and the average of the energy of f along this, again, is less than psi. Just a remark, you can also choose the point w bar such that f is less than psi tilde. It's important, this psi tilde will be not the same psi, obviously, but will be a quantity that depends on psi, and you can make the choice good enough in such a way that also psi tilde goes to zero as delta goes to zero. And what is the argument? Okay, what is the argument? Maybe it's better to have a replacement, a figure always with us, because it's... a very small figure, sorry. But at least it's something. Okay. So let us suppose that the average integral of f is less than psi. And the 3 points, we saw this in the ball of previous one. All the construction that we are making, so for example, we can fix psi, we can now agree that all the psi tilde will be less than one, okay? So the construction we're going to do will be well located on B16. So as you can imagine, this is just a technical point, okay? Now, what do we do? Let's fix 3 balls centered at x, z, and w bar, okay, with a radius psi tilde to determine less than one. So we are in the P2 of P. Now, let's first choose w bar, okay, by using the segment inequality. By using the segment inequality on BW and B4, we have that the average on the points of BW and B4 of the geodesics connecting them, okay, we have this bound. Okay, now just, okay, every geodesic from BW, since psi is less than one, every geodesic from BW to B4 stays in B8, then we have this bound. Then we can increase this to 16, put the average and put B16 here, but now this is less than psi. So what we have is that the average on this product of balls is less than C psi, the sum of the balls times B16. Hence, by the average, there exists a point in BW such that this integral is less than the average on BW. So you have a point such that this gamma holds, this formula gamma holds. So the integral over B4, so look what we are doing. We are giving a bound on all the average of the energies from W tilde to B4, okay? This will appear in the iterated segment inequality. So if you have divided by BW just because you take, there is a point on which the integrand is less than the average of the integrand. And now what? By the trick is this, by Markov's inequality, you can find a couple of points in the product of BX and BZ such that this double integral, which is the average, so W bar is fixed, and now we are taking the average of all so you're taking all the geodesic gamma x tilde z tilde, and you're taking the average of all, okay, you're taking a double average, but you have a point here such that this one is less than 3 times the average integral of this, the same, okay, and this one is less than 3 times the average integral of this. Why? Because you have a bound. If you put here 1 million, this is clear because the measure of the set on which you have a bound by a big number times the average of the integral is small, okay? It's big. And then if you have enough space, three is enough, you can find a point on which you have this double control. But now what? Use alpha, use the iterated segment inequality, and gamma, that is exactly the term that you have in the iterated segment inequality, and you obtain that the things that you wanted to estimate, which was, okay, you find x tilde, z tilde, a geodesic, you obtain that the integral over all the geodesic of the integral of f over all these geodesics is less than what? Some computation, here you have this appearing, and you also, by the iterated segment inequality, you have this appearing, but here you have the average and you have also this. So you have C times BX plus BZ over BX BZ, blah, 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 okay? So you have this bound. At this level, we didn't choose psi tilde, okay? I rewrote this here, okay? But also now it's simple again, by beta, you have, again, you have the bound. So you have the bound just of the energy along this geodesics. And again, you have this comes from the segment inequality and this by the fact that it was less than three times of the average, okay? Now let's just look at epsilon. Now I want to make the choice of psi tilde in such a way that this is less than psi. And we need to use Bishop-Grom theorem. Just write the basic fact is that you have the sum over the product. So it's the sum of the reciprocal. Since B1P is in B2Z, since the distance from P and Z is less than one, you have that B1P over BZ is less than B2Z over BZ, and this is Bishop-Grom. The radius of Z is psi tilde, and you think, oh my God, this is a problem because this is exploding, but you have a psi here. And you are free to choose psi tilde in such a way that this is not exploding. This is the main point of this argument, okay? Thus, what you obtain is that the reciprocal of BZ is less than what? Than this, just rearranging. And then, just continuing epsilon, you have a constant, then you have this, but then there is also B16 that saves you, that you can absorb this by Bishop-Gromov in the constant, okay? And then the things that you hope to be close to zero is less than a constant times psi, which is going to zero, and the volume in the constant model of section curves minus delta of radius psi tilde. You want that psi tilde goes to zero also, and you also want that this ratio goes to zero. And now just tell psi tilde, choose psi tilde such that, for example, this, so if you, such that this is exactly square root of psi tilde. So if this is psi, really psi, not changing psi, you can choose psi tilde such that this is the square root of psi. You can prove that then psi tilde goes to zero because then psi tilde is a radius such that its volume is square root of psi in a model that is tending to be Euclidean, and then the radius should go to zero. And then you finish, okay? This is important to check, but and also for delta, you have to argue at the same it's sufficient to choose psi tilde such that the volume goes like psi of one of the cube square root of psi. Okay. And now let's prove the Pythagora theorem, okay? Probably it's better to put here this. So while I'm doing this, if you have questions, feel free to ask. Okay. Let's prove the approximate Pythagora. So it will take just two slides. So without loss of generality, we can assume that, okay, maybe it's better also to have the figure here. This. I should have copied. Okay. Without loss of generality, we may assume that uz is less than greater than uw, that is zero, because delta splitting is invariant by translation. Okay. Now, since the gradient of u is less than 1 plus delta, because we have a splitting map, and since uw is zero, then we have that uw bar is less than psi. And I will call this double tilde. Okay. Now, what do we have? We have that C and W, okay, yes. We have that C and W are almost on the same level sets of the, we have that, okay. What we have is that the B property, so the fact that UZ minus UW minus DZW is less than delta. That's not the zero level set property. Ah, but that it's not is the picture that we should have in mind. Sorry, let me see. X and Z around zero level set. Yes. Okay, I hope there is no confusion with the W, X, and Z. Let's see. Okay. Okay, since we have these, okay, the fact that, so this was the hypothesis B, from B, we obtained what? We obtained that if we call D tilde, the distance between Z tilde and W tilde, then, okay, from B and the fact again that the gradient is less than one plus delta, again, you can use the this hypothesis and change uz tilde and uw and uw tilde, you can change it and obtain that uz tilde minus uw tilde, okay, minus d tilde is less than psi. Okay, so this is from B. From B and the fact that the gradient is less than one plus delta. Okay, so we have this and I will call this tilde. So what now? That is, I can write uz tilde minus uw tilde as the integral of the derivative of u along the geodesy connecting z delta and w tilde. So that is, this is the integral of, from zero to d tilde of what? Of the gradient view of u of c composed sigma dot minus one, okay. This is less than psi. Because, okay, if you integrate minus one, you obtain minus delta tilde, this is the derivative of u composed sigma prime from zero to d tilde. So this is u composed sigma in d tilde. So this is u of z tilde minus u of w tilde. Now the aim is to put the modulus inside, okay? And then the point will be to read this proof and to understand geometrically what's happening, okay? I'm just putting under the row, okay? So, and to put the modulus inside, I want to do this, I want to make this estimate, okay? So let's see, let's prove that along sigma, nabla u is almost sigma dot, okay? But to prove this, okay, let's expand this. So this is from, so we have the square of this, that is one integrated, and so it's delta tilde. Then you have the integral between zero and delta tilde of the gradient of u composed sigma square. And then you have minus two, the integral between zero and d tilde of gradient of u composed sigma, sigma dot. But we can add the subtract inside a two, and this becomes minus delta tilde. And now this is less than what, since we have that this holds, and we have this here, okay? This is less than minus delta tilde plus zero, the integral from zero to delta tilde. Okay, I will put the minus delta tilde inside. Okay, so I have this minus one plus psi, because the modulus of this is less than psi. Okay, good. But now, since the gradient of u is less than one plus delta, this is less than psi. And since d tilde is bounded because it's this between two points that are in a compact big ball of radius 100, so this is less than psi. And now what? Hence, now I want to show that I can put the modulus inside here, and I will use this, that the integral of the gradient square minus one along the geodesics is small, okay? Otherwise it will not be possible to obtain this information. And the fact is that if I take the integral between zero and d tilde of nabla, of the modulus of nabla u composed sigma, sigma dot minus one, this is using the triangle inequality, I can add and subtract a gradient of u here, and this is less than this plus what, using Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, you have the gradient of u composed sigma times what, the norm of gradient of u composed sigma minus sigma dot. But now, the first term is exactly, remember h was the displacement of the gradient square by one plus the Hessian square. So if you have a bound like this here, it's exactly to have a bound with psi here. But also this, we show that the L2 norm of this is bounded by psi. This is uniformly bounded, and then this is less than psi. And we really put the modulus inside. But what does it mean to put the modulus inside there? It means this. It means that u sigma t minus u sigma zero minus t, which is the integral between zero and t of the gradient of u sigma, sigma dot minus one, again, fundamental theorem of calculus, is less than the integral between zero and t of gradient of u sigma, sigma dot minus one. And this is less than psi for every t in zero delta bar. So it means that along sigma, the value of u, remember on sigma zero, the value of u, so sigma zero is w bar, and the value of u is small. So along this geodesic, the value of u is increasing at a constant rate. So it seems really that this u is the gradient along the so you are moving orthogonally to the level sets of u, no? Okay. So again, I suggest you to read all this proof and to give a geometric meaning of what's happening. The geometric meaning is should be clear. Okay. And then what? And then U of sigma t minus t is less than, using the result above, psi plus U of W tilde is the triangle inequality, and that is less than psi because of tilde tilde. Okay. So U is really the distance between, so you're moving along the level set. And now what? Okay, so, sorry, so tilde tilde was this, and I will call this theta, this equation theta. Okay. So what? Let's finish the Pythagorean theorem. So again, sorry, I need this. Okay, define L of S to be the distance from X tilde to sigma S. So it's this distance, okay? The geodesic is for almost every S unique, it's tau S, it was tau S. And it's just the first variation. The derivative is the angle of the two tangent vectors. So it's sigma dot tau s prime dot ls. So remember that tau s is this geodesic, okay? And now we want to estimate what? We want to estimate, so 1/2 of the distance square between, so d tilde, okay, let's estimate this. The distance between x tilde and z tilde minus the distance between x tilde and w tilde. What is this? This is 1/2 of the L function at d tilde. Remember that d tilde was the distance between w tilde and z tilde. Squared, so it's exactly this distance, okay, minus L square of zero. And this is 1/2, this is again the theorem of calculus, L sigma, L prime sigma in the S. Good, but L prime of sigma is what I wrote here. So it's the integral between zero and d tilde of sigma dot, it's better if I put all the variables, tau s prime of ls, l prime of s, the s. And now what? Add and subtract the things that you know is sigma dot. Sigma dot is the gradient of u, okay? You know that it's almost the gradient. So this is the integral. Sorry, there is no 1/2 here, obviously, because the derivative of r squared is 2 L prime. Okay. Okay, so this is the integral between 0 and d tilde of the gradient of u sigma s tau s prime of ls L. Sorry, this is L of S. Okay, because this is L prime. Okay, good. But and now there is a term that we are adding and subtracting, and so this is sigma point S minus gradient of U sigma S tau S prime L S L S the S. And now what? Okay. You can see that we can add a fake variable in the first, okay. Okay, we want to use an estimate on the second order. So this is the integral between zero and d tilde of gradient of u. So sigma of s is the ending point of tau s. So this is, by just rewriting things, it's this. But now I want to add a fake variable. So this is the integral between zero and al s of dt ds. Just I'm writing that something is a constant integrated on zero al s, and then that's why you have this al s here. And then you have the same term here without changing anything. Okay. And now the reason why I added this fake constant is that I want to substitute this with this fake constant and then estimate the remaining term with something on the second derivative. Okay. But this is the integral from zero and d tilde, zero at to al s of the gradient of u in tau s of t, tau s prime of t dt ds. Okay. Then you have again the same term. And then you have a difference term, which is exactly this minus this, which is exactly the variation from t to al s of the function that is the gradient of u times tau s prime. So it's the integral of the derivative, but the derivative of this is the Hessian along the direction tau s prime. So this is from zero to d tilde to zero to ls, from t to ls of the Hessian of u tau s prime. And the magic is here, sorry, r, because now we can estimate everything. So let's call, this is term one, this is term two, this is term three. The term one will be the last. Okay, so let's start with the term three. The absolute value of three is what? You can bound in this way. I will write and I will explain. The integral from zero to d tilde, the integral from zero to ls, the Hessian along tau s prime r, tau s prime r, dr, ds. The modulus of this, you can, okay, you just put the modulus here. And then what? You increase this to zero, okay? You exchange these two integral. This is constant now, it doesn't depend on t. So you have an ls that you can bound with the maximum. And then what remains is exactly this. But we have chosen, yeah, recognize exactly the outcome of the iterated segment inequality. In H, remember that there is the Hessian square. And this is exactly the average on all the energies here. And this is exactly the average on all the energies. So this is less than psi, because this is uniformly bounded. So first part of winning time, second part, and now, the L2 norm of this was bound. Okay, there is not square, but the L1 is bound by the L2 user holder. This is bounded in a norm, in the integral sense. We showed it. Oh no, sorry, where is it? It's here. The L2 norm of this is bounded. This is in norm one because it's unit, all the geodesic are unit speed here. And LS is bounded, so also 2 is less than psi. And now for the first term, we have to suffer a little bit, but not a lot, because now if we add 1/2 d square of w bar z bar, this is exactly, look here, you are integrating, you are integrating a derivative in t. This is the derivative of u composed with tau s, okay? So here, this term is the integral from 0 to d tilde of u of sigma s minus u of x bar, the s plus 1 over 2 of this. But now, what we proved? We proved that u sigma s is almost s. Okay, remember what I told you before? U sigma s, sorry, if I now write s plus or minus psi, I'm thinking the modulus of the difference is less or equal than psi, but this makes sense, okay? There is always the use of triangle inequality. And u x tilde is from one part is u of zeta tilde plus or minus psi, because x and z are on the same level set of u. And from the other part is d of y tilde, w tilde z tilde plus or minus psi, because u of w tilde is almost zero, and this is almost orthogonal, okay? So we are using hypothesis A and B, no more than that. So I can put an S here, and I can put a d tilde here. And the magic happens again. This is exactly plus or minus psi. It's just a matter of computation. Ah, sorry, there is a plus or minus psi. So what we proved? We proved that this quantity is 1 + 2 + 3. This is small in norm. This is small in norm, and 1 + this term is small in norm. So if we subtract here d tilde square, we obtain that this is small in norm. Then we can neglect the 1/2, just multiplying. Then L squared d tilde minus squared 0 minus d tilde square is less than psi. But this is exactly the distance square of x tilde z tilde minus the distance square of x tilde w tilde minus the distance square of what's left, w tilde z tilde. And now we can change x, z, and w with x, z, and w tilde, because the distances are really small. And we obtain the, we finish the proof of the almost Pythagora theorem. So the main idea was to use the segment inequality to infer a bound on the energy of the splitting function along geodesics, and think about what's happening in the geometric, what's the geometric meaning of what you want to do. You have these, and here you have x and w, and here you have z. And you are taking a geodesic here, and you want to prove Pythagora theorem, just by seeing what happens to this. So think about what's happening in the Euclidean case, reading the proof to understand what's happening. And so we have proved the approximate Pythagorean theorem. I think that this is enough for today. What's next? So this is something that will give us an isometry in the contradiction argument, a distance-preserving map in the contradiction argument. Then we will need something that will give the surjective part. So we will need to prove that if you have a point X, you can really find a point Y that is almost on some level set in a strip around X, and it is almost orthogonal. Then we will put everything together, and with the contradiction argument, it will be readily seen that the almost splitting theorem, the fact that you have a splitting map implies that you're splitting space. So I think that next lecture will be the proof of this almost surjective part with the conclusion of the proof of the from splitting space to splitting, from splitting map to splitting spaces. And then that's actually a little bit more easy. We will prove that the hypothesis of the almost splitting theorem will imply the existence of a one delta splitting map. And then everything together, we have the proof of the almost splitting. Okay. So I think I'm finished for today, and tell me if you have some questions. Sorry, I wanted to give you the entire proof of the almost splitting theorem. So the details is something that I had to do, because this was the aim of this course. So.
All right, sounds great. Thanks so much, Joaquino. It's really nice to see the whole details, actually. It's quite a hard proof, but it's very satisfying to see them in full glory. So thanks so much for the very nice presentation. Okay, so is there any questions, any further questions from the audience?
Well, I will have to go over the proof again. Definitely, I will have to download the lecture and revisit it, but it was great.
Yes, think that, okay, as an exercise, you can write down an alternative proof of Pythagoras theorem using this argument. Mm-hmm. in the Euclidean case.
In the Euclidean case, right.
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
No, so yes, just read everything thinking about the Euclidean case and what's happening. And, mm-hmm.
Okay, so I'll put the notes I guess tomorrow when Joaquino sends them to me in the website, and we're trying to be as effective as we can with the editing of the videos. But if you want to see the video before the next lecture, I can definitely send you the raw footage of the video, so you can check it before we edit out. So we don't lose time with that. So if that's the case for you, you can send me an email. I'll put again my email in the chat now, and then I can send you. Okay. So I guess if that's all, well, thank you so much again, Joaquino. And the next lecture will be on November 30th.
Yeah,
at 9 a.m. Mexico time and 4 p.m. Italy.
Yeah. Okay.
All right.
All right. Thank awesome. You. Thank you so much.
Awesome lecture.
All right. Cheers. Thanks, everyone.
Okay, so see you next week.
Yeah, okay, sorry for the big delay this week. It was quite a It was very hard.
If I bothered you, I didn't know.
No. It's of course my. I wanted to apologize. It took so long to update the website and with the video, but it will be much better this week. So.
Yes, there is the problem of the fact that all the three lectures are the same.
Yes, I have that in my notes here to correct.
Okay. So see you. It seems that probably I will not have to prepare the fourth lecture.
Yes.
I will.
Okay. No, it's quite a hard work to present all these details, and to be honest with you, we try to read it. I tried to read it before myself, and it's so hard. So it's really nice to see all the details laid out.
Yeah. Thank you for the opportunity again. So we will see you next week.
All right. Sounds good. Thanks. See you next week.
Bye-bye.
Ciao.
So.